So Lord Iltari has a Subscribestar, also known as the Paladin. I would really recommend anyone who's invested in this story to go over and check it out. It's a solid way to help support the author and help get stories like this written. So check out the top link in the description. Though let's start, will we? Be me, Paladin. Be Prince Kazdor Glamdring, Abbess Senkit Zarathustra, War Master Julian Turan, Inquisitor Andre Silverthorn, Legate Yort Son of Hort, and Chef Peregrine Horser Rider. Paladins and a few other things of Order Undivided. The sun is setting on the end of the first day of the Paladin's impromptu tourney to see who the greatest fighter of them is. Of the six combatants, Senkit, Kazdor, and Peregrine have pulled ahead, some more comfortably than others. Andre, Yort, Peregrine, and Senkit are all already sleeping off their injuries. This leaves Julian and Kazdor still up, and Julian retires to his quarters to resume his studies shortly after dinner, a somewhat blander affair with Peregrine out of commission. So, Kaz returns to his own quarters, down near the cellar. He ducks under the doorway and walks into the small chamber he has set up for himself down here. He pulls out his flask, and briefly considers refilling it. Then he shakes his head and sets it by his bedstand, to serve as a reminder of Bluggle. With that done, he heads over to the small desk he keeps and pulls out a fresh sheet of paper, a quill, and his inkwell. He dips his quill and begins to compose a new letter home to inform his father and clan of all that he has been doing. About halfway into the page, he hears a knock at the door. "Come," he says, turning to see who it is. "Ah, Cravine, what brings you here?" he says pleasantly to the dwarf who enters, switching back to the dwarvish his forked tongue finds more comfortable. "Apologies for the interruption, Prince Kazdor," the dwarf says. "He is a good fellow, Cravine, a smith by trade, though not of any memorable skill. He is a stout fellow, about half as wide as he is tall, so that if he were to be stretched out he might come up to Kazdor's chest. His face is sparkling, eyes peeking out from the small canyon of tan skin visible between a magnificent beard and equally mountainous eyebrows. There is a new arrival at the Abbey, and I thought you might want to know of him." "Curious." Kazdor rises from his chair and stops up his inkwell, following Cravine up the stairs and out to the main hall. "So did the guards just let him in?" "No, he's still trying to get in."
"What do you mean, trying?"
Kazdor is answered by the sound of a very, very large axe slamming into the door.
"Oh, you could have just said it was Uttar," he says, rather calmly, before taking off and flying over the gate. On the other side is a dwarf with a shaved head and a massive orange beard, dressed in what can be best described as spikes with armor bolted on, trying to knock down the Abbey's gate with an axe about the same size as he is.
"Uttar, if you wished to announce your presence, there are ways of doing it that are less costly to repair," Kazdor calls out to the battle rigger, and the unusually tall dwarf turns. And his face breaks into a grin when he sees his old friend. "Dracus. You've gone and bloody grown wings while you've been away. You didn't bother to mention that in your letter. A lot has happened between now and then. Now will you kindly stop breaking down my gate and terrifying the soldiers? You can pretend to be civilized every once in a while. Only for weddings and funerals, and only then for the ceremony, not the reception," the mad dwarf says with a laugh. It takes some doing, but the guards' respect for Kazdor is enough to make them overcome their trepidations on letting the berserker into the Abbey. The two walk in, side by side, laughing at old jokes together. Uttar looks around at the Abbey, peaceful in the night, and sighs happily. "This place, well, the clans that lived here in ages past certainly knew their work, and all of this from sandstone too. It's a proper fort, but doesn't feel like it even though my head is telling me it's a castle. It certainly was harder to get into than most of the castles we wound up running into, I'll give it that. It's strong, but not a place that is meant to use its strength except to keep the peace. I can appreciate it. Peace. With you, Dracus?" Uttar laughs. "It really has been a long 5 years since you left, melting your footsteps as you went. Not having to deal with the long beards and brother helps," Kazdor says with a chuckle. "Though I suppose it's my duty to ask, how is Thorgrim?" "Eh, his nose is still broken, and he's still holding his grudge against you, especially after you broke his shield. I think he's still got the pieces hidden away somewhere. Well, it has only been 5 years. I guess he can just toss it on with the rest of his sourness against me."
"Sourness?
Ha. At this rate he'll write a brand new book of grudges and they'll all be against you." Uttar laughs, and Kaz shakes his head. "Well, at least I'll have a legacy." The Dragonborn answers, and there's bitterness in his voice. "I imagine he'd probably just write me out of the histories if he wasn't writing that book." Uttar stops, and Kaz stops with him. The bald dwarf sighs. "Aye, he would. The long beards too. They've gotten worse since you left,
and with the king getting on in years, they're building more power. There's a reason I came up here after you. I can't go back, Atar. I have too much yet to do here. I'm not saying you should, you wouldn't find any friendly faces anyways. So the half or so of the clan that could stand me were liars. Bah, the hell's with them, Maradin knows his own. No. I'm not the only one coming here. Atar says, and Gus turns to him. About half stayed, but I'd say maybe a quarter of us decided we had some grudges of our own to fulfill and aid to offer our brothers afar. We won't stand idly by when our prince is in exile. I'm not. The hell you aren't. You left because the wingers and the whiners were driving the king half mad and greyer every day. You're one of our best and you're 1,000 leagues from home. Thorgrim. Thorgrim can come and have a rematch if he so fancies, but as it is, he is the heir and the crown prince, I am not. Me staying would have just caused more madness in the hold, and now a full quarter follow after me. Have you forgotten loyalty? We left because of loyalty. Loyalty to our prince. Loyalty the old fools on the council forgot because you're. Because I'm Dracus, not the real Khazdor Glaemdring, just his replacement. Khaz says flatly. That's not what I was going to say and you know that. Don't put their words in my mouth. Enough. We'll speak with the Abbess about this in the morning. Get yourself to a bed. Khazdor says, waving his old friend away. I'm too sore and tired to fight this battle again. Atar sighs and gets himself to a bed, and Khaz shakes his head, walking back to his small room. He looks at the letter on his desk, then seizes it in a talon, crumpling it into a ball in his hand. The parchment catches light from the heat of his fury and he tosses the ashes aside. He takes several deep breaths, cooling off, before climbing into his bed and shutting his eyes tightly. Khazdor dreams, and dreams deeply. As he sleeps, his fangs are bared, his talons clench on the handles of an invisible axe. An old battle plays out, a ghost whispers discontentedly, a mighty dwarf looks up briefly from a crafting table, where he forges a miniature dwarven soul, then turns away in disgust. Khazdor awakes with a roar, and also naked, on the floor. His bed is a smoldering wreck around him, as are his pants. The dragonborn grumbles and makes a mental note to see about getting it replaced, as well as making an appointment with the tailor. After getting dressed, Khaz wanders up to the dining hall for breakfast and sits down near Senkit and Peregrine. Sen raises an eyebrow upon seeing the dragonborn's clearly foul mood and slides him a mug of coffee. He drinks it wordlessly and eats without saying much. We have a wee problem, he says after a while. The new dwarf, Senkit asks. Dwarves, plural. It seems a quarter o' me bloody clan is following me north. 500 o' me folk, that's gonna provide an oozing problem. Peregrine nearly spits out his beer. 500. Ye gods, cause I know we need allies, but that's a bit too much too quickly. I was neither one who called the buggers heir, neither one tay drive them. Ye can thank me brother for that. Skinner. He mutters darkly. Peregrine and Senkit share a worried look. Gone is cause his bravado and bluster, this isn't even his explosive fury. Instead, it's a soreness, like a wound that hasn't healed properly, and a bitterness that scares them far, far more than rage. Peregrine thinks fast and then raises a solution. Avernius's lair. It's underground and mostly hollowed out already, they could fortify it and make a temporary hold until we find Draken Festug. The halfling exclaims. Khaz brightens. Aye, that could work laddie. Ard needs tay lead them there, but that's near great bother. Saves us having tay deal with more bloody politics tay boot. Right. That's out of the way, but that's not what's bothering you. Sen says. Khaz brushes it off. Bah, just a bad dream, I'll be fine. Dinny think a wee bit of untidy sleeping will keep me from sending your scarlet ass flying all over the ring. Khaz, will you please save your discussion of what you'd like to do with Senkit's ass for somewhere other than the breakfast table? Julian says as he sits down. He ducks as Senkit throws a bowl at him, then gets back up and walks away quite quickly as Senkit also gets up and speedwalk chases him out of the dinning hall. Khazdor turns slightly redder and makes a great point of eating his porridge. Later, Khazdor and Atar meet up and Khaz leads the berserker, sunspikes and giant axe, in a tour of the abbey. The next stage of the tourney has been pushed back a day due to injuries sustained by the combatants in the last section. Undri and the Order still in the hospital, though both are healing quickly. As they walk, the two enter the chapel section of the abbey, and come upon an unusual sight. Senkit isn't wearing her armor, but has instead donned a habit. She is bowed before the altar, and the sun is flowing in from the window above, illuminating her in light. It is a strange thing, a woman of unnatural and seductive beauty, clearly marked with the forked tail, cloven hooves, and sharp horns of the hells, clad in the pure chaste white of an abbess. Baptized in light before the altar of the holy gods. That's the abyss. Attar says, dumbstruck. I'll be damned, that's a loss for men everywhere. He says, quietly, and in Dwarvish. Side note, Attar can speak common, but his accent is so incredibly thick that it is not possible to convey the sheer amount of Scottish he produces in text format. None of the players can actually understand him when I use his common voice either. Attar, I will be careful. That woman is as dangerous as she is beautiful. You know that tawny I mentioned. She is probably the greatest obstacle to my victory in that particular contest. Wait, a lady of the cloth who fights? I'm a priest as well, lest you forget, and yes. That is a woman who has held armies at bay by herself, so show some respect, you lecherous fool. Dracus, if I didn't know better I'd call you smitten. First Julian and now you, I don't need this nonsense. Dracus, that's not a name I've heard you called. Senkit answers the squabbling pair, in Dwarvish. Both men go remarkably still, and several shades paler. Oh yes, I do know Dwarvish. I was born in an abandoned hold actually. You could have mentioned that at some point before. Gus says, and Senkit gives him a bit of a grin. I thought it might be funny to see what your face looked like when you found out I was right. She says, smiling kindly. Cause Dor isn't sure what he's more dumbstruck by, the fact that Senkit knows Dwarvish, or the fact that she has a sense of humor. I have places to be and things to do like, not die. Attar says, edging away towards the door and then booking it away. Kuz watches him go and is surprised to hear Senkit laugh for the first time. It is not a particularly pleasant sound, for it is cruel and harsh, a devil's laugh. She recognizes this too and stops. So, Dracus, what's that all about? She asks Kuz, trying to move away from that. It's rather clear why she doesn't laugh. Oh, that, a nickname I called myself for a while when I was younger. Attar's the only one who still calls me that, I grew out of that phase. Gus says, mildly embarrassed at the memory. Gods, I was stupid then. He was just as stupid, but at least I grew out of it. There's a charm to it, I suppose. Sen says. I can understand the desire for a different name though. Oh. Why do you think I never mentioned my last name? Ah, fair point. You know, you are the one who normally tells me off about issues with my family. It seems you're speaking from experience. Kuz Dor sighs. Aye lassie. He says, switching back to common. Senkit raises an eyebrow, but doesn't say anything. HM, how about a bargain then, or a wage rather? She suggests. If I win, you'll tell me. Bah, ye give I up on it that easy? I'll thank ye for it. Oh, now what was that you said about me holding off armies? She says, grinning in a challenge. Kuz Dor grins right back. Ye might hold off armies lass, but I break 'em. Be me, paladin, quite sore from my own rather extensive travelling as I write this. Long legs are a blessing when walking, and a curse on trains. Because Dor Glamdring, Senkit Zarathustra, and Peregrine Horsa Rider, finalists for the tournament of the paladins. Beandre Silverthorn, Eort son of Hort, and Julian Tyrion, not the finalists but still mighty warriors more than capable of tracking me down and flaying me if I dies them. Due to the odd number of finalists, there is a bye into the final round of the tourney. The remaining three cast a 20-sided die Eort had in his possession to see who would win it. Kuz Dor rolls a 6, Senkit a 9, and Peregrine a 13. Winning with an unlucky number. Halflings in a nutshell. Julian says with a bit of a chuckle. Peregrine shrugs helplessly. It's not like I have any control over it. The Arsimer shakes his head in incredulity. Fate isn't something he usually believes in, but halflings might be an exception to that particular rule. Senkit and Kuz Dor look at one another, grinning. Looks like you're out of luck, I won't be worn out from fighting Peregrine. Ah, it's Nima poor luck, it says. Ah, didn't he have to waste me fire o me magic on the wee laddie just to get to ye. Undri and the Ort look at the two taunting one another, and the smiles on both of their faces. We're gonna need some more healing potions, and we? The hobgoblin says. And possibly some extra bricks for when they put each other through the walls. Oh, most certainly, on the upside the onlookers know well enough to keep their distance after Kuz and Julian's match. Fair enough. I don't think Senkit has the offense to win this though. Eort says. She beat you by endurance and a lucky hit, but Kuz has about the same level of staying power, and he definitely has her beat on the offensive portion. They might be able to take about the same number of hits, but I think you underestimate just how insane Sen's defenses are, and I wouldn't attribute that last hit to luck. Sen's able to take a beating, but even if her defenses are overwhelmed, she's too stubborn to lose. We'll have to see. Looks like they're about to start. Indeed, they were, both Crimson Crusaders entering the arena. Both look their best, Kuz Dor clad in his shining armor, looming over everyone watching. His axes gleam, his cloak of scales blows in the wind, clinking against his armor. His face is cheerful to those who know him, but for those who don't, the handsome scales show an unreadable stoic mask. All can see him can sense his noble bearing, the piercing clear blue eyes of a just and righteous prince. Opposite him, his opponent is the embodiment of beautiful contradiction. Her horns are sharp, her eyes pools of golden flame, her tail lashes at the sand. Yet the fiend bears a shield with the mark of the heavens upon it, and armor suited for a hero. She is plainly beautiful, the kind of beauty which drives men mad and brings on wars. In spite of this, her armor is adorned with cloth like an abbess's habit, both warrior and guide. This is going to be good, Andri says, pulling out a small tin of ghost clis and beginning to munch. Yort looks at her in horror. Where did you get those? They were near my bed, I assume Sen left them for me. Ah, no, for one, I left those there, and for two, those weren't for you, those were for interrogations. Please stop eating the torture devices. Why did you leave torture devices in the hospital? The surgery theater makes for a very good torture chamber, and the tools for both are more or less the same, it just mostly depends on whether or not the person on the table is conscious. With that mildly disturbing side conversation out of the way, the coin that's standing in for the gauntlet comes up, flashes once in the air, and falls to the earth. You'll see why I chose this music in a minute. Kazdor is fastest on the draw, blasting Senkit back with a massive torrent of flames. The Tiefling raises her enchanted shield, and the magic flickers as it holds out against the dragonfire. Kaz rushes forwards as he lets loose this torrent, cutting it off as he swings in from the side with his axe. It catches Sen right in one of her armor's weak points. First blood to Kazdor. Senkit shrugs off the blow and slams her shield into Kaz. The dragonborn crosses his arms and blocks it, not moving an inch. She raises her morning star and swings in twice. Both times it bounces off the armor, leaving impressive dents. Although there is no easily visible damage, the impacts still jar and bruise even through the dwarven plate. Kazdor retaliates with three rapid swipes. Sen blocks the first with her morning star, deflects the second with the shield, and takes the third on her shoulder. She rolls with the hit, using her armor to its maximum effectiveness, turning what should have been a solid hit into nothing more than a scrape along her plate. Her counterstrokes are in vain though. Kazdor is simply too large and strong to push over with her shield. Even beyond that, his training under the dwarves has taught him to take blows from ogres, orc barbarians, and giants without moving. While Senkit is easily as strong as almost any of these, he is well prepared. He has also learned from her earlier blows and deflects her mace away to keep it from doing any real damage. Both slide back half a step after these first engagements, studying their opponent for any weaknesses. It is clear that they are quite evenly matched. Senkit's shield allows her to close in with Kaz despite his far superior reach, whereas Kazdor's understanding of her armor is allowing him to strike at weak points. Furthermore, it also tells him how she is going to move, as the heavy armor means her motion is limited and falls within a more predictable area. Kazdor shifts his grip slightly, and Senkit peeks over her shield a bit more. Each one sees the other's slight movement as a potential opportunity, and they strike. Mace and axe clash against each other, then shield and axe. The two physically mightiest members of Order Undivided strain against each other, muscles bulging and sweat forming on each of their brows. Kazdor has the better leverage, but Senkit the better bracing. Something has to give though. Something gives, the wooden haft of Senkit's morning star. There is a crack as the sturdy oak breaks. It was quite strong, and well made, but dwarven axes are made entirely out of steel. Still, it surprises Kaz as much as it does Senkit, leaving him slightly off balance. Senkit takes her chance and shoves for all she's worth, forcing Kazdor to stumble back and knocking his other axe from his hand. Kazdor regains his footing before he completely falls, but his focus on recovery gives Sen a moment. She dives in a roll for the fallen axe, and he lunges for it as well. Here though, Senkit's shorter height is an advantage. At just 2 inches over 5 feet, Sen has almost 3 feet less than Kaz to go between her and the ground. She grabs the axe and cuts upwards, striking the big dragonborn in the chin with his own axe. Kaz's head snaps back in a spray of blood, but his reflexes are still solid. He raises his arm and deflects her follow-up, then grabs her forearm. Yanking her forwards, he throws her off balance and too close to him to use her shield. He strikes her twice in the back and shoulder from above with short axe. Blood begins to flow from the Tiefling's back. Undeterred, she leans low, pushing against her opponent. Kaz has no choice but to let go and step back or fall with Senkit on top of him. Julian, I'm aware you're snickering in the background, stop it. She steps through after him, swiping horizontally. Kazdor deflects the first swipe and blocks the second. The axes lock against one another again, and sparks begin to light from where they grind against one another. Not wanting to see his weapons damaged, Kazdor actually drops his axe, leaving both his hands free. The sudden loss of pressure leaves Sen off balance, and thus she's caught off guard when Kaz wraps his arms around her and picks her up off the ground in a tight grab. Kazdor's cloak flares into its wings, and he soars into the air, before turning backwards and plummeting towards the ground. The crowd looks away, wincing as a cloud of dust flies up from the draconic apex. Sen's brains are slightly rattled, and her horns are stuck in the dirt after that. She rolls upwards and sees Kaz going to retrieve his axe. Unable to reach it in time, she throws the first thing that comes to hand to knock it away and out of the arena. Unfortunately, in her slightly stunned state, she throws her own borrowed axe, and knocks both out of the arena. Kaz turns, slightly surprised, and she pulls herself to her feet and charges, pushing him back for the first time, almost to the edge of the ring. He raises his talons above his head, wraps them together, and brings them down on her back with a shockwave that sends her to her knees. He kicks upwards, but she catches it on her shield and staggers back to her hooves in time to catch another fist on her shield. She gives back as good as she gets, pushing it aside into an uppercut that staggers Kaz back. She jumps into the air and turns, acting more like a monk than a paladin as she places a hoof directly into his face, smashing it back. She lands in a crouch and hits him in the stomach with the side of her shield. Kaz wheezes and falls backwards to a knee. Kaz forces air back into his burning lungs as his vision blurs, then he sees Sen's hooves. He grabs her by them, and lifts her over his head by the legs, then body slams her into the dirt. As she tries to push herself back up, he drops the people's elbow onto her back, pummeling her back into the dirt before pushing himself back up. Eort and Undri watch on, both mildly amused and slightly horrified at that how this has basically turned into fully armored WWE. Senkit rolls over, and her eyes go wide as she realizes she's right next to the edge of the ring. If she had been just an inch further forwards, that wouldn't be it. Of course, this gives her an idea. She pushes herself up and shoves into Kaz once again. The big dragonborn is braced and doesn't move. Just as expected. She drops low, digs into the earth, and strains for all she's worth. Kazdor realizes his danger just a moment too late, as his feet leave the earth. Sivrid tries to fly him free, but it's not enough. Senkit heaves the 700-pound dragonborn over her head on her shield, and then slams him flat on his back outside of the ring. Kaz lies there for a second before he can catch his breath, then he notices the line. Kaz grins, which makes the part of the audience that doesn't know him shrink back in fear, and then starts to laugh. He laughs long and hard as he pulls himself to his feet and shakes hands with Sen, who winces a bit. Shoving several hundred pounds of dragon over your head is a good way to pull something, it's a good thing she can't get her hernias. Kazdor's good mood and generally good sportsmanship is infectious, and soon the mood is generally good. It wasn't exactly a duel they witnessed, certainly not when compared with the Orton Peregrine's match of blades. But in a competition between the two physical bruisers of the paladins, it was perhaps even more suiting. There is a 4-hour break between the matches as Senkit recovers and Kazdor gets to work repairing her Morning Star. Peregrine decides to take advantage of the unusually pleasant day, and the fact that most everyone is already outdoors at this point, and declares under his authority as chef that lunch will be served outdoors. Much picnicking and merriment ensues. Even Julian is coaxed out of his nest to participate in the bright day. As he wanders the grounds looking for a quieter place, he notices a small gaggle of children, humans, halflings, and a pair of kobolds, playing about with a series of small wooden weapons. One is holding two short swords, one two axes, one a stick bound into a crude bough with a string, one with a pot lid and a rolling pin, and one with a very large stick that he is stumbling about with. As the small lad nearly falls over backwards onto him, Julian reaches down and catches the stick, keeping him upright. The child looks up, and his eyes go as big as dinner plates. Julian helps him up, and takes the small human's hands in his, moving them to a different position on the stick. It's a lot more top-heavy than mine, but this should do better. Keep it like that and you should have the balance right. He coaches the young mimic. He stands upright and draws his own magnificent blade from its sheath. The children stand back in awe at the blade as he demonstrates a few basic swings. The one playing Julian mimics his movements, although sloppily, and he falls down again. Julian chuckles and puts away his sword to help the lad up. Not bad, though you'll need some practice, and probably a better sword. Unbelievable, Senkit says as she watches him. The big brain playing with children. I never thought I'd see the day. She jokes to Andrea as the two women sit under one of the apple trees in the abbot's orchard resting. It's strange, isn't it? Not 2 weeks ago he ripped out an ox heart and ate it, and now he's playing with children. I've seen Buzz tear out a demon's eye and she's lying there getting petted. Andre remarks. Though I suppose it makes sense, he really is a rather loving person. Loving, Julian. Sen says with a mild snort. I think all the people we've killed have something to say about any of us being loving. You're starting to sound like Peregrine. Andre remarks as she takes a bite out of an apple. But really, he is. He's cold, callous, stupendously deadly, and a terror to anyone who's in his way. We all are, except Kaz, and he's red hot with rage. Yeah, and wrestling moves apparently. Sen says as she picks a bit of dust out of her horns. But be serious, aside from his mother, who have you seen him act lovingly towards besides books? Did you hear his oath? Yeah, what about it? Every single thing he fights for is ultimately for the benefit of mortals, for other people. He's completely disinterested in the gods precisely because he doesn't think they're doing enough for people and he wants to do more. That all matches the definition of love. You and I have very different definitions. HM, more of a language barrier really. Common only has the one word, love. Elvish has some 40 different ones. I still don't understand how humans get by with such an imprecise language. A, at least it has a word for it. I don't think the concept even exists in Infernal. What would you call how your father feels about you then? Insanity. After a thoroughly enjoyable luncheon, all are gathered once for the final round of the tournament of the paladins. Peregrine is relaxed, smiling, joking with the audience. Senkit is somewhat less relaxed. She is well aware that Peregrine outclasses her in raw skill, but she has no intention of backing down. After all, Senkit outclasses Rox in stubbornness. The final match. The crowd draws to a hush as Williams prepares to toss the final coin. As it flies, Senkit begins a prayer, beginning quietly, and the world seems to slow as the sun glints on the copper. Peregrine's hands grasp his hilt tightly, the wind blows and then ceases, Senkit's prayer nears its end. The coin hits. Peregrine's swords leap from their scabbards already ablaze, his bare feet kick up the dust in a cloud as he rushes forwards. Senkit's prayer ignites, her mace reforged with a solid steel handle of brimstone. Her hooves grind as she steps forwards, her faith gathered around her in a gleaming remnant. They meet in a flurry of sparks, cinders, golden light and writhing shadows all about them. Peregrine's blades meet against shield, armor, mace, air, and mace again. The two meet eye to eye, glinting killer's hazel against infernal gold. Peregrine grins like a maniac under his cap, and they lunge again. Shadow and light fly off one another in novas. Their weapons lock for a moment and grind together, before Sen's superior might breaks through and lands a blow on Peregrine's shoulder. The smaller duelist falls away, before cutting back, hitting her at a joint on her knee. The dark power makes her shake and stumble, and Peregrine's other blade scratches across her cheek, rotting it away. Both pull back, and their injuries, a blazing broken shoulder and ghastly cheek, show the onlookers this is no friendly competition. These are two warriors in the prime of their life with great and terrible magics at their disposal, using everything in their toolkit to bring the other down. Peregrine shifts his foot, and then vanishes in a screen of sand. He feints to the left, then comes in from the right, baiting out Sen's defenses to strike her in the side like a viper, then slink away from her counterstroke. She lunges, bringing her mace down far faster than the halfling expected. He brings his blades up in a perfect guard, but it isn't enough to keep it from scoring him on the head. He dodges to the side from the next swipe, but the next blow catches him anyways. The blessed mace is supernaturally accurate and quick. He lands, his hip wounded, but even still, the agile halfling keeps pace, baiting Senkit forwards, and then sliding under her. He cuts her hamstring, elbow, and shoulder in a single motion. The supernatural mace comes in again, but he has its speed now. He steps back from the first swipe, making it miss him by inches, then deflects the second with a counter so quick even Andre can't track it. He steps back in, catching Senkit in the breast with a stab while slashing her across the upper thigh, then revering the cut to drag the tip of his blade back across the tiefling's left wrist, hitting her on the inside of the shield and damaging the straps. This maneuver was perhaps a bit too ambitious, as Sen swipes in with the shield and finally connects a shield bash. Before she can throw the small duelist from his feet though, the damaged strap tears, forcing her to adjust her grip or drop the shield. Still, it keeps him back. She strikes down, and as he sways back away, she reveals her true target, his unarmored barefoot. Her mace comes down and smashes it. Peregrine howls in pain, hopping back in a faint retreat, then counter-attacking with a vicious lunge. Not enough though, as his blade slides against the shield. For a moment it looks like a repeat of the nearly fatal blow he received against Clanny, but the paladin has learned from that. He places his hands flat on the shield and pushes up like in their fastball specials. He turns in the air, and slashes open Senkit's neck on both sides. Blood fountains from the wounds, each one on its own enough to drop someone into unconsciousness from blood loss in mere moments. Even Senkit must bend to the whims of flesh, surely. Her spirit is strong, beyond the limits of weakling flesh. Peregrine has been underestimated many times in his career, but today he is the one who underestimated it. Senkit turns, shield still raised even as she loses enough blood to paint the sands red. It looks like she's about to fall though, she bends over. And she throws her shield. It hits Peregrine midair, knocking him off balance. He lands in a roll, coming up as Senkit charges at him. He tries to step back, but his wounded foot fails him. Perhaps fate could have intervened here at the 11th hour, or perhaps it already did, just not in his favor. Senkit blasts aside his defenses and delivers a mighty blow. There is a flare of light so bright that the watchers must avert their eyes. When it fades, only one paladin is still standing. Senkit Zarathustra, the heroic spirit stronger than flesh, stands over the unconscious body of Peregrine the duelist. The others rush to their friend's aid, staunching the flow and getting Peregrine back on his feet, then they raise Senkit up on their shoulders and carry the triumphant knightess back into the abbey to rest. When the feast arrives in the evening, with all its pomp and splendor, it arrives with many bowing their heads at the coming of their champion. At the high table, the counselors and the paladins bow, and then raise their glasses to their friend, their abbess, their champion. Hail the champion of paladins. Hail the brimstone dragoness. Hail to Senkit Zarathustra. The abbess takes her seat, armor discarded, but mace still at her side, just in case, then answers their toast with one of her own. Hail to Hearthfire. Hail to the heavens. Hail to Order Undivided. Be me, Paladin the World. Because Dor the Justice, Andri the High Priestess, Peregrine the Wheel of Fortune, Senkit the Hierophant, Julian the Chariot, and the Ord the Moon, fated Paladins of Order Undivided. The Paladins and their council meet once more in the Cavern Hall, with the celebrations and festivities of the tournament past, it's back to business as usual. Specifically the business of dealing with the oncoming immigration of 500 Glaemdring dwarves. The plan for housing is relatively simple, to house them in the Hollow Mountain once occupied by Avernius, approximately 3 days' travel from the abbey. However, other concerns remain, most prominently food. The colonists have brought enough food and been few enough in number that they can get by with fishing and hunting in the short term, but with the continuing new arrivals, food production must increase. Arguments go back and forth regarding what parts of the wood to begin cutting down in order to start farming, as well as continuing concerns about the blight and monster attacks. Once again, it becomes clear that the races must work together in order to survive. After much debate, it is settled that the section of forest between the mountain and the abbey are what should be cleared to lay down farming and the roads. The halflings will return to their village to begin cultivating it again, the dwarves shall help clear the woods and keep the path safe, while the humans and goblins cultivate it. As for the kobolds, they will set up a new hidden burrow in the area and assist the dwarves in creating facilities and static defenses to be built along with additional housing using the wood they gain from clearing the section of the forest. Throughout all of these debates, Julian and Andri both notice the actions of one particular bard, always so reasonable, but always shifting things in such a way as to give the humans and him in particular the best deal. Considering his influence, this could be a problem. In between the meetings and the many debates, the party attends to its other business. Senkit continues to lead the abbey's spiritual as well as political life, managing it aptly and with little regard for nonsense. Kazdor maintains the forge, crafting and repairing armor, tools, and weapons for any who need them. Andri and Peregrine walk the woods, documenting game trails and dealing with nuisances like the occasional wolf or bear. Yort busies himself with maps and charts and tables, running the abbey's finances and laying out plans for the road between the mountain and the abbey. As for Julian, he is unusually active in the community, being found almost anywhere that help is needed, speaking with the colonists from all races, hearing their concerns and doing what he can. Furthermore, he begins to direct a militia, working alongside Yort to drill and train the colonists into a force able to defend themselves and fight as one. Those who show particular talent he sets apart and begins training as an elite unit. He even manages to find a young human woman with a small talent for magic and begins to coach her in certain ritual spells. All this, combined with his charismatic persona, begins to rapidly advance the ambitious Arsima's standing. While he was once a little known member of the party, now he is swiftly becoming well known and respected, while William's support begins to wane. This peaceful existence continues for about a month, before a report comes in from the Southern Watchtower. The dwarves are coming. The paladins know what this means. Once the dwarves arrive and are settled, it will be time to once more set out into the unknown to seek Drake and Feastin and Fee Karen. Their sparring sessions with one another intensify, their focus shifts towards preparing to set out once more. Then, a few days later, they arrive. The first that the Abbey knows of the dwarves is the sound of singing, low chants that carry wide across the forests and plains, a choir of 6,000 voices raised in the tale of their history. Cazdor hears it and smiles. They are singing a song of triumph. Cazdor goes forth to meet them in all his splendor, clad in shining armor with civet draped about him. The cloak has been quiet this month, slowly but surely evolving and adapting to its new powers and its more complete form. Senkit also goes with him, clad in the armored abbess's robes that have become her symbol of office, a martial nun, a mighty sister of battle. The throng comes before them, at their head is one clad like a captain of the guard. Long is his beard, and white like the snow. His armor is finely crafted, his shield is sturdy and his warhammer strong. His face is wrinkled with centuries of both laughter and sorrow, but his eyes are still as sharp and bright as a young man. Cazdor smiles, but also hides concern. The long beard approaches and clasps his fist to his chest in a salute, then drops to a knee. My liege, I have come, with those sons of Glaemdring who yet still remember their loyalties to their prince, and the mighty works you have done for us. Rise, Grombadril. Cazdor orders his vassal. I am not your liege, that is my father, Duthos, assuming he yet lives. Nonetheless, I welcome your aid and your coming. It is good to see that my friends are true even when I am long departed. Of course, Lord Cazdor, I and my throng stand ready to aid you. Grombadril says, then looks warily at Senkit. If I may ask, who is this? I am Senkit, servant of Zeriel, heir of Arvidor, abbess of Hearthfire Abbey, champion among Order Undivided. I stand here as representative of those who have come before you and welcome you to the Summerlands. Senkit answers him in perfect Dwarvish. The old dwarf is taken quite aback by this, as are the others in his company. Senkit smiles diplomatically, welcomingly, and just ever so slightly smugly. He blinks twice and regains his composure. Ah, my apologies then, Abbess, I accept your welcome. If Lord Cazdor is for you, then I shall not stand against you. I am. Cazdor says with just the slightest hint of a growl. You are accustomed to unorthodox allies though, so it should not be much of a problem. Likewise, you and yours are not to be against the elves here, nor the Groby who stand with us. Their grudges have been satisfied. As you will, needs must as the Dowager drive, so it were. Indeed, now come and follow me. We have much to discuss. As they walk, Cazdor fills Grombadril in on the situation, as well as the mountain that would serve as a home for the new arrivals. Ah, a goodly place to start a carack, or if it is not large enough, perhaps a cursed, if Carrick Drake in Feastin is to be reclaimed. Soon, old friend, soon. It is my full intention to seek it out as soon as you are settled, and once we have found it, to dedicate all our might to reclaim it. Very well then, though the mountain could serve as a fine outpost near the south. Perhaps Cazd Gliendrak for a name. The dragon was anything but little. Cazdor says with a minor chuckle and a bit of a wince. But that is a fine name indeed. So, it shall be. A thane will need to be appointed of course, a small council readied, and all the rituals and preparations observed. There is not yet a thane, nor a council, only a king may appoint such a one. It shall be under until such time as my father may name a thane, and you likewise may manage it in my stead. The long beard looks slightly disappointed, but nods. I shall take care of it then. Ah, Abbess, I have meant to ask, but to what gods are the abbey dedicated to? It is dedicated to the Heavens Undivided, and therefore the Great Seven, Bahamut, Maradin, Cord, Pula, Eronios, Tyre, and Helm. It is within the specific dominion of the Archangel of Adventurers, Zeriel, and the under the Eye of Aximund, Solar of Cord. Your offerings and rituals will be accepted without incident. Ah, very good. If I may, I would ask a boon. Senkit says, and the long beard raises an eyebrow. I am told you are a runic carver, able to store magic within stones. That I am, Abbess. Would it be possible to create a permanent zone of truth, that we might have a court and council where there can be no deception? Perhaps, though the time and money that it will take to create such a thing would not be insubstantial. I am in possession of a dragon's hoard, good dwarf. Gold is not exactly a resource I am strapped for. And so, the dwarves came to Hearthfire. Grombadil and his aides soon set to work examining the cavern hall that would be used as both a meeting room and a court of arbitration. After a week of work, he grudgingly accepted Undri's aid. Julian's apprentice, Mary, also provided assistance by constantly maintaining a detect magic spell throughout the process. As for the arcanist himself, he busied himself in the process of creating a certain document. He read a great deal and spoke with the wisest members of each race as he worked, the other members of the paladins assisting when they could. Another month passed while the dwarves worked. The mountain was soon made a good enough home for them, though they yet grumbled and worked to improve it further. In time though, the mountain was brought to their satisfaction, and the runes were carved in exchange for a substantial amount of treasure. The work was begun on clearing the woods away and planting would soon begin. It had been a good rest, but now the time had nearly come to once more sally forth and seek Drake and feast him. Before they went though, Julian called together a meeting in the newly enchanted cavern hall and presented the document he had long labored over. It was a contract and a concord, a compact and a constitution, a binding document to lay out how the lands would be governed. A council would be formed, with a representative from each race and village to come together. Each race and village would govern itself, but when disputes arose, they would be arbitrated by the council. Likewise, each race would contribute to a mutual defensive pact and standing army to defend them all. This army would be under the command of the office of Lord Commander, which the paladins would fulfill and appoint their successors to. Finally, the council could propose and enact legislation that would govern the whole of the Summerlands. The paladins would also have a vote and could also propose legislation. The capital would be the Abbey until such time as Zahn Jonas could be liberated and rebuilt, and the capital would be under the authority of the Lord Commander. The capital would not collect taxes, except on trade, but would still command the United Army. In times of crisis, the council could be superseded by the Lord Commander or the leaders of the affected areas. After many long hours of debate and argument, the document was signed. History would record this as the signing of the Hearthfire Compact, and the beginning of a new nation, unlike those that had come before. It will in time include many kingdoms and small villages, all united but not by an emperor, but by a mutual agreement to stand as one against chaos. It would have a ruler who was not a king but a servant, a council chosen by the people and by the nobility. Many tribes, tongues, races, and nations would call it home. Here, far away and isolated from the rest of the world, a nation was born, though it did not know it yet. Here was created a union that would take its name from those heroes who bled and fought for its foothold, to secure it and make it new. Here was born the Ordanic Union, first of the Paladin States.